Hello everyone, welcome to another learning episode. Today we'll be learning a new lesson for oral communication. But before we proceed to our discussion proper, let me ask you some questions first. Have you ever experienced conflict or misunderstanding with the one you are talking to? Can you share your experience to the class? And what are the strategies you use in order to resolve the situation? So today, class, our lesson will be all about the barriers to communication and the different strategies we're going to do in order to make sure that we will avoid communication breakdown and we can ensure that we deliver an effective communication to the people we are talking to. At this time, we'll proceed to our discussion. The first barrier to communication is what we call lost in translation. Do you have any idea what do we mean by lost in translation? Loss in translation happens when the receiver of the message perceives a different meaning from the message being sent by the speaker. This happens when the speaker uses words that have double meanings that create misunderstanding or confusion in the part of the receiver of the message. Loss in translation doesn't necessarily mean that there is a language barrier that's going on. This happens usually if the words, phrase, or sentences delivered by the sender was perceived differently by the listener. So what are we going to do to avoid this situation? If you are the speaker, what are the strategies are you going to make sure that you are not giving confusion or vague ideas to the listener or the audience of your speech? One strategy that we could use to ensure that we are actually not giving vague statements to our listener is to ensure that we are using clear words and our intentions are laid right away and the message is direct. Now, if you are the receiver and you already encounters loss in translation while listening to the speaker of the message, what are you going to do? Now, if you are on the receiving end, what you're going to do is go directly to the source of the message, ask for clarification, draw questions, direct any confusing messages, and ask the speaker himself to clarify the intention of the message in this area or in this part. However, there are cases that you no longer have the chance to speak to the source of information or the speaker himself. What you can do is go to somebody who is expert or has similar background of information or knowledge to the speaker or the source of information. And instead of going to the speaker, you can go to this person to ask some information and to ask some clarification as well, if you do not really have the chance to speak to the main source or the speaker himself. Now let's proceed to the second barrier to communication. This is what we call the short attention span of the listener. Human as we are, naturally, we can only listen for a few minutes and then our mind will jump from one thought to another because we have short attention span. So what are you gonna do if you are the speaker and you already know this truth that the listener or the audience that you will have has short attention span? What strategy are you going to use in order to make sure that the listener will be engaged to the communication process? One good way that you're going to do is to make sure that you deliver an interesting topic and make sure that you repeat all the important details, because I always believe that in repetition there is power. The more you repeat the important details or information, the more it will be stored in their long-term memory and they will never forget about these things because you keep on repeating them and it will register in their mind that you are giving emphasis to these ideas. Now let's proceed to the third barrier of communication, which is too much information. Well, too much information is not actually good. Too much of everything is not good. Everything should be set in moderation. Why is it still true in terms of communication? Have you ever tried listening to someone talk for 3 to 4 hours, a very lengthy speech? Were you able to absorb everything, or were you able to understand the whole message of the speaker? This is the reason why too much information is not really advisable when you are talking to someone or when you are engaging in a communicative process, because too much information can lead to communication breakdown. As a speaker, for example, if you're invited to speak in a gathering and there is a certain topic given to you, what are you gonna do in order to make sure that you will not be giving too much information to your audience? One thing that you're going to do is to prepare, to make a plan, to make an outline already of your speech, so you will not beat around the bush. If you already have an outline of your message, you will be giving a concise and a well-thought message to your audience. How about if you are the listener or the receiver of the message? Right now, we have plethora of information around the world. What are we gonna do to make sure that we are not overloaded with information or facts? So since we are bombarded with so much information in our day-to-day lives, it is very important that as a receiver of the message or a listener of the message, we learn how to filter out things. We would know which ones are true and which ones are not, and which are the information that is aligned to our values and that are aligned to what we believe in. This way, we will not be overloaded with so much information, and we know how to limit ourselves also. And we have the next barrier to communication. This is what we call language barrier. I don't think I'll give further definition of this one. This usually happens when two people have different languages. This happened to me when I was in college, since I was born and raised in a Cebuano town. When I went here during my college years, because I did not know how to speak in Hiligaynon, so I was always silent all the time, and I was just there observing all their words, all their statements, how they deliver the messages. And there were times that I often misunderstood a single word mentioned by a friend of mine or by one of my classmates because I was not familiar with the word. So this is the reason why language barrier is one of the factors why we have communication breakdown most of the time. There are cases, people, that even though we have the same language, still language barriers do happen. Why is it so? Why is it happening? Even though we have the same language, even if both of us are speaking Hiligaynon, there are still cases that we misunderstand each other. What do you think are the reason? Well, there is what we call jargons. Jargons are the specialized vocabulary used in a specific field. For example, I am a teacher. I have a different vocabulary compared to my students. I am talking to one of my class and I am asking them to make their own formative assessment and diagnosis to one of their classmates. Do you think my students would understand these terminologies? Of course not, because formative assessment and diagnostic assessment, these are all terms used in an educational field, meaning these are the jargons of the teachers. So jargons are different in terms of the field that we are in. If you are going to go to a hospital and the doctor is explaining to you about medical terms and scientific concepts, and you are just an ordinary person who doesn't have a background about medical terms, so do you think you will be able to understand the message being sent to you? Of course not, because you have different jargons. Another thing, even in the family, generation gaps also create barriers. In the case of my students, they belong in the generation Z because they were born in the year 2000, while their parents are baby boomers. There is a big gap between these two generations, and right now there are so many internet slangs. Generation Z students are very familiar with these internet slangs, and if they ever use these internet slangs to their parents, do you think their parents will be able to fully comprehend what do they mean about these terminologies? Of course not. This is the reason why language barrier is often one of the main factors why we cannot communicate fully with the person we are talking to because of so many gaps around us. Now, how are we going to solve this one? What strategies are we going to use to ensure that we can deliver effective communication though we are in the different fields or we have different dialects or we belong in different generations? If the two of you have different language, one thing we could learn is to make use of our nonverbal expressions. We can make use of hand gestures to point something or to use our body language. If we cannot verbalize really what we want to tell to the other person, then we use the nonverbal signals. However, if you are having different jargons, for example, it is very important to make use of simple terms or terms that are used by a layman or an ordinary person to ensure that the other person could understand what you're talking to. If you are a doctor and if you are explaining a certain illness to your patient, you have to make sure that you use simple language so your patient could understand how to take the medication, how to take care of himself or herself. Now, if you have different gaps naman, it's important to like meet halfway and to understand that my parents could not understand this slang term, so I'm gonna be using a different term in which both of us can understand. Next barrier is what we call psychological barrier. This involves your emotional state or your mental state. Psychological barrier affect our way of communicating with other person also. If we feel stressed or frustrated, we are not that receptive to the message being sent to us by the speaker because we are not feeling well at that time. Have you ever tried talking to someone and then you are at the height of your anger and instead of fixing the argument or the situation, you even make it worse because you have said hurtful words toward this person and you regret it afterwards? This is the reason why it is important to be emotionally stable while talking to someone, because if you are at the height of your emotion, you will not arrive at a certain understanding and you often develop conflict and misunderstanding with each other. It is very important to be highly sensitive while talking to someone. Check if he or she is going through something. Because if the person is going through something at that time and you want to talk to him or her, he or she will not be that receptive and he or she cannot give you his or her full attention. Now, let's proceed to the next barrier, and I believe this is one of the important issues that we have to touch also. This is using generalizations and stereotypes. Why is it that using generalizations and stereotypes create misunderstanding or conflict during the communicative process? When we create hasty generalization to someone, we are not actually befriending them. We are actually creating enemies out of it. For example, if we only have encountered one person from Manila and this person did something bad or something mean to you, and then you right away generalize that all the people in Manila are rude or are mean because you've encountered a bad experience with someone from there. And that is not actually fair, because you are already generalizing the people even if you haven't met all of them. And then we also have stereotype, and Filipinos are very stereotypical people. We often judge people based on how we see them. Like the gay community, for example, they are often stereotyped because of their sexual preferences. So what are we gonna do in order not to establish unprecedented generalizations and stereotypes? It is very important to accept and to embrace the inclusivity that we have, the differences that we have as humans, and we should not judge people based on what the media portrays them to be or what the other person is saying about them. One value that we need to develop is to make sure that we develop respect to one another. So another barrier is what we call dysfunctional feedback. One of the definitions of communication is it is the process of exchanging ideas and information with one person to another. So in the communication process, feedback is really important. And as a speaker or as the receiver of the message, you have to make sure that you are going to give feedback to the communication. I've tried this talking to someone, one of my friends, and then I was really excited at that time to share this piece of information. But then the feedback that I received was a nonsensical feedback and I just laughed it off. So instead of continuing the conversation, I just cut it off right away because I no longer want to talk to him at that time. So this is the reason why feedback is really important. So if the speaker, if somebody sends you a message, you have to be very attentive and you have to make sure that you provide an appropriate feedback to what he or she is talking to. And then it is also important that the speaker also listens to the feedback of the receiver of the message. in the process of communication, your reactions, your receiving, your manner of receiving the message, and your way of giving feedbacks are all important because it ensures the smooth flow of conversation. And now we are down to our next barrier, which is the lack of confidence. Why is being shy a hindrance to effectively communicating? Being shy or having low self-esteem could block our ability to express what we need, to express what we want to share, or the information that we want to deliver. So it is very important to develop assertiveness. If you want to say something, you have to speak it out. When I was young, I was too shy also, and I was quite reserved. When I was in grade 3, I was not feeling well, but then I still went to school. I did not tell my teachers and even my classmates at that time. I was just sitting in the corner trying to listen to the teachers, but then I feel so dizzy to the point that I just passed out and everybody was panicking already, including my teachers and classmates, and I even make it worse. So it's very important that we exercise our rights, our opportunities to speak something, especially what we need, because the more we like suppress what we feel, we are just making everything worse. We should practice like telling what we need. We can start at home. Whenever we need something, we can tell our parents. We can be more open about it. We are now down to our last barrier, which is noise barrier. Noise is really one of the common barriers that we have in communication. During the face-to-face class, this is one of the problems teachers often encounter, especially if your total population is 40 and up students inside the classroom. Noise could really be a barrier, and there are times that whenever you are giving instruction to your students, they couldn't hear it clearly because some group of students are talking loudly. What we usually do as teachers is we set boundaries. We manage class by setting the rules or by giving a warning to these few students who are loud enough, who are very loud in the class. So if you want to talk to someone and you will be talking some confidential or sensitive things, it is very important to choose a place wherein no noise barrier could hinder your communication, and then you can talk privately, at least in a much more quiet environment, and that is very important. So again, these are the different barriers to communication and the different strategies we could use in order to ensure that no misunderstanding or communication breakdown will happen along the way. So for my grade 11 students, this will be your activity. What you're going to do is to choose one of the barriers mentioned or presented from the video, and then show a solution. What are you going to do in order to make sure that you can resolve this conflict or this hindrance to communication? You should be one of the characters in your video presentation. Please do not voice record. You should be the one acting it out together with your family members or one of your classmates. You can group, you can do it individually, or you can have it by pair or by three. Thank you so much for watching this vlog. I hope you have learned a thing or two from this presentation. Keep on learning!